Hey everyone, I'm Richard with Google Cloud and joined here by Sarbjeet. Tell me a little bit about yourself and what you do.
Hi Richard, nice to be with you today. This is Sarbjeet. I do technology strategy consulting with CXOs, Fortune 2000 companies.
Awesome. Well, I wanted some of your perspective then as we think about, you know, cloud consumption, multi-cloud, some of the things going into the mind of the CIO as they're figuring out their strategy here. So is there anything that people chose based on a few years ago that you're seeing deprioritized now? That first generation of cloud adoption, did people say, hey, this matters a ton, and now you're hearing it a little bit less?
Yeah, it was not that it matters less, but there was misconceptions about the cloud. People thought cloud is less secure. That concern has gone away. So some of the objections we used to hear early on, like 10 years back or 8 years back, they're kind of going away. Now the main problem people talk about is the complexity. Complexity of the number of services provided by the cloud providers. And then also we have been talking about multi-cloud for the last 3-4 years, a lot more for some reason, even though it was there before. So having that multi-cloud consumption model figured out, that is a big challenge for consumers, if you will.
Yeah, that seems like a hot topic. Maybe it's some of our fault since we seem to talk about it a fair bit. So what is the side effect of going multi-cloud for an enterprise, both good and bad? Like, what do you see when people make that choice either intentionally or even not on purpose and kind of organically?
Yeah, I think the side effects are good-wise that you get to use the best of the technology, right? And by the way, I usually say that nobody wakes up in the morning and says, like, I'm going to do multi-cloud, right? It's hard. It's not easy. It falls in our laps because we did an M&A or we picked as part of the service from a provider, which was like the pricing was so compelling and or the performance was so compelling, or the combination of these two was very compelling that we went there for that kind of workload, if you will. So for whatever reason we do the multi-cloud, I think it adds a layer of complexity. But at the same time, I think buyers have to think through the operating of those like two, if not n number, of working with the n number of cloud providers and what complexity that brings in. I usually go into the talent side of things, right? Because to consume the APIs from different providers, you have to train people on different technologies, right? So it will collide with your uniformity of training your employees, I believe. And in case you're using, let's say, two clouds almost at the same level, or 60-40 or 70-30, you have to keep those people trained and you have to hire a certain way. So I usually talk about a concept, what I call skills gravity. Skills have gravity, I usually say that. So if you're using one cloud provider's technology or those APIs, people tend to use those all the time. People want to polish those skills, if you will, as individuals, as individual contributors. Their main thing, what they sell is, right, is their skills, right? So techies by nature want to go deeper into, especially developer community, right? And as we know, that infrastructure is becoming code, right? So even the infrastructure folks or the operations folks are becoming developers. So on the other side, you can say the developer community is coming into the ops side of things, if you will. And some of the old ops people, like people just doing pure ops, they are coding now, right? So they are behaving like coders, and coders want to be on the cutting edge all the time. So there's a inherent flaw between what business wants to do and what these coders want to do. So where I'm going with that is, I think that will bring in some complexity. Like, people want to, you know, go deeper into one set of technology, and then where you're trying to tell them, no, you have to look there too. So it's a little harder, but the good thing is that you can get price to performance, and then vendor diversity is a big thing for, especially for Fortune 100 to 200 kind of customers. you want multiple suppliers for many reasons. For one goes down, or one is being broken up by the regulators, or whatever reason that is, data sovereignty issues can be there with certain vendors more than others. So you want to have ties with another provider so you can switch easily because you already are working with them.
So let me ask you that, to build on that a little bit. So when you see CIOs or executives choosing multiple clouds, and I don't see too many who are choosing literally 50-50, usually have a primary and a secondary or what have you. And then oftentimes the cloud may even be pinned to that department or division, or that subgroup. Are you seeing a lot of cases where individual departments are using a lot of different clouds? Or is that typically siloed off, hey, this group uses this and has the skills gravity for that, this group uses that? Are you seeing that mix up?
I think it's mix up. I usually call it, if that's the case that one LOB is using one cloud provider and other is using other, besides the M&A kind of sort of scenario, I call that a sort of lack of vision or weaker sort of leadership at the IT level. I mean, that's how I see it.
So you'd prefer not to see that. You'd prefer that at the higher level, you're making a tactical choice that in general, I don't care which group you're in, this would be our primary cloud and this would be one for other workloads, this or that. That would be your preferred design?
Yeah, I will prefer that when I'm running the show. And also I recommend that to people because you pick a primary cloud and you focus there, and then there's a secondary one. So for certain kind of workloads or special needs and or vendor diversity or risk management, if you will.
Good. Well, I wanted to ask you too, there's been some spicy debate lately about repatriation and moving workloads on-prem and that sort of fun conversation. And you've written in the past and talked about in the past about cloud inevitability and that there seems to be a somewhat inevitable move to the public cloud in general. Are you seeing, I mean, I'd almost like to get you a prediction on the record. Do you think more workloads are moving from cloud to on-prem or from cloud to cloud?
Yeah, I think in future, definitely there'll be more traffic going left to right from one cloud provider to other, if you will, from up to down, means like from your data center to the cloud, by the nature of it, right? Because we are moving more and more workloads to the cloud, you know? So I think that's natural, but overall, I think more and more workloads will go into the primary cloud provider for any sort of a customer you pick. And cloud is going to grow at the pace it's growing, at least for the next 5 years, if not more.
Yeah, good. So good conversation. So any parting thoughts on multi-cloud? Sounds like when I read into some of your answers from earlier as well, you know, having a thoughtful strategy here, making sure that even if you maybe started organically, coming in over the top and having some good choices on what's my primary and others. Any other kind of final guidance as you talk to leaders and managers and others as they might pursue this sort of strategy? What's a good piece of advice?
My piece of advice is that trying to go to the vendors who embrace the multi-cloud, like they at least they mention that in their literature and their marketing messaging. You know where I'm going with that, right? So you guys have Anthos, you guys talk about it. So I think it's a welcoming kind of step, because the hard part is the complexity, you know, of multi-cloud, and any vendor who can solve it, I think it's a good day for the industry. But there's a long way to go. I think that push has to come from the cloud providers. Another request my thought, which I put it out there all the time, is that to the cloud providers is that they have to throw a lot of education at the developers. Like developer relation teams have to be very strong. If you really want to win the cloud war, you have to invest a lot there, because developers are the ones who will gravitate towards your solutions. But also, they will give you a lot more sort of, your feedback loops will be very like well-oiled, if you will. And especially in the multi-cloud world, right? They can tell you the pain points, and they can tell you like you're doing better by publishing the API early on, or giving us a lot of examples and different sort of source code in different languages. You know, there are SDKs and there are different ways we consume cloud, right? Like pure code-based consumption of cloud. If you can put that a lot more out there, I think it goes a long way.
I think even your CIO guidance, as you think about, you know, choosing vendors who are leaning into this, I think that focus on education is super key, sometimes gets underrated. And then in your last part of that answer is also just listening to your developers and keeping that feedback loop open, because these should not just be top-down decisions. You want to, the buyer is often different than the user in these cases. You want to make sure you're listening to the user. So that's terrific stuff. Well, I really appreciate you joining us here today to gab about all of this. And thanks for your time.
Thanks, Richard. Enjoyed it. Thank you.